Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to today's talk, The Neutrino Story, From Impossible Dreams to Unreachable Stars. Many of you may be aware that a popular monthly lecture series, Copy with Curiosity, were taking place in planetarium till the pandemic started. Since about a year and a half, curiosity during quarantine lectures are happening. And thanks to the great effort by the ICTS team. A few words about Planetarium. Jawaharlal Nehru Planetarium is engaged in the dissemination of science through various programs. We have popularization programs aimed towards general public and non-formal science education programs for students interested in science. I would like to briefly mention about the activities that are taking place here now in the planetarium. Last year, we initiated several online activities. We are regularly uploading videos entitled Sky This Week, and we have done several educational videos which are uploaded in our YouTube. We had three celestial events in the last 1 year. We had an eclipse in June last year. Then we had great conjunction of Jupiter and Saturn in December, and we had zero shadow day last month. We had arranged for web streaming of all these, and the analytics say that tens of thousands of people have seen these programs. We organized a pan-India activity on April 24th, the zero shadow day, in which more than 15 centers in India collaborated with us. We took readings and students measured the circumference of the repetition of the great experiment by Eratosthenes some 2000 years ago. And some of the centers which participated in this are from Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, then Jaipur Planetarium, Aryabhatta Foundation from Bhopal, and Physics Teachers Association from Jammu and Kashmir. All these participated. Our year-long non-formal science education activities for high school students and REAP program for undergraduate students were conducted last year also, but on the online platform. And during this year, during the month of April and May, we have organized several workshops. We had a Tiny Tots workshop for primary school students. We had three batches, and nearly 52 students participated in these. Then we had a workshop called Experiments to Explore, which was attended by some 40 students. And we also had a workshop called Exploring the Solar System. And we are planning to organize more workshops. We have a paper-based science activities program, which for the age group of 8 to 10 years. Then we are also planning to have app-based program where our smartphones are used as these can work as instruments. Several activities can be conducted using that. So these are planned for first week of June, and please look forward to our announcement from us. Now coming back to our today's lecture, we have very senior scientists, Dr. Subhapati Goswami, to tell us about ghostly particles, neutrinos. I extend a very warm welcome to you, madam.
Thank you.
I extend a cordial welcome to all the audience who are online. Now I request Dr. Rukmini Day to introduce the distinguished speaker. Thank you.
Thank you, and warm welcome to everyone for the KDK event today, hosted jointly by ICTS and Jawaharlal Nehru Planetarium. I'm Rukmini Deh, a faculty of ICTS. On behalf of ICTS, it is my great pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Professor Subhapati Goswami. Subhapati did her PhD in Calcutta University and is currently a senior professor in PRL Ahmedabad. Her topic of research is neutrino physics, and she is a member of India-based Neutrino Observatory Collaboration, Puraskara, and the J.C. Bose National Fellowship of CERN. She is an elected fellow of all the three National Science Academies of India and the World Academy of Sciences to us. It is a great pleasure to have her here today with us. She'll be talking on the neutrino story from impossible dreams to unreachable stars.
So maybe I can start.
Yeah. Yes, please.
Thanks a lot, Rukmini, for inviting me to give this lecture. And it's very nice for me to be able to share the neutrino research with you. And as Dr. Pramod said, that you know there are a lot of activities taken by the planetarium, and I am really very happy that you know I'm very happy and honored to be a part of it and share some of the exciting research areas of current days with you all. So, and I hope that you know as I end the talk, the title of the talk will be clear to you. So, the main characters, let me introduce the main characters of this story. These are the three neutrinos, the electron neutrino, the muon neutrino, and the tau neutrino. And these are the, you know, Roman symbols, nu, by which we denote them always. And, you know, E is the electron, mu is the symbol for muon, and tau is the symbol for tau. And there are the side characters, which are the electron, muon, and tau. Together, they form a family, which is called the lepton family. So in this family, we have the electron, muon, and tau, and nu e, nu mu, and nu tau. So this is called nu. And they have different properties of mass, charge, and something called a spin, which is some kind of an angular momentum. And you know, now there are other elementary particles about which we are not talking. And you know, each elementary particle has its story of discovery, you know, why they are important. Today, I am going to confine my attention and focus on the neutrinos. And it will be clear to you why, because these are very fascinating particles. They are slightly different from the other elementary particles. So that's why we will start the story of the neutrino now. So the story of the neutrino started in 1930, and it started with a letter by physicist Wolfgang Pauli. And what did this letter say? This letter said that, dear radioactive ladies and gentlemen, in order to, I have hit upon a desperate remedy to save the law of conservation of energy. There could exist electrically neutral particles that I wish to call neutrons, which have a spin half and obey the exclusion principle. I agree that my remedy could seem incredible, but only the one who dare can win. Dear radioactive people, look and judge, your humble servant, Pauli. So this was a letter actually written in Germany and German. And you know, this is a part of the letter translated from that letter. And the point is why he had to write this letter. To understand that, let us go back a little bit to understand what is radioactivity. And it was discovered by Henri Becquerel in 1896. And there are subsequently it was found that there can be three types of radioactive emission. So I am audible, Rukmini, right?
Yes.
Okay. So, you know, now to understand the radioactive emission, maybe all of you know, but I am not sure. So I will just explain a little bit that in an atom, we have a nucleus and we have in this nucleus, we have neutron and proton, and outside orbit, we have electrons. And radioactivity occurs when these nucleus for heavy atoms, when the number of neutrons are higher than the protons, means very roughly speaking. And there are three types of radiation. One is the alpha radiation, which is emission of two protons and two neutrons. So this is the alpha particle. It's nothing but a helium nucleus. And then there is a high energy electron can be emitted. So a neutron can be converted to a proton and an electron. That is called the beta radiation. And then there can be a high energy electromagnetic photon, which is called the gamma radiation. Now, a problem was encountered while studying beta decay. Now, as I said, in beta decay, a neutron gets converted to a proton and an electron. And what happens is that, so, you know, this happens in a nucleus. So, if supposing I have this cobalt nucleus, which has 27 protons, so then it becomes a nickel with 28 protons and an electron is emitted to balance the charge. So here is a cartoon. This is the electron and this nucleus is saying that I am a charged one. So it gains a charge. Now, what happened was when people were studying the beta decay spectrum, then it was found that there is a continuous spectrum energy distribution of the electron. So the energy of the electrons emitted in beta decay was measured and it was found that the energy distribution is continuous. However, if you can see, then this is something called a two-body process, like a particle A is going to another particle B and C. Now, if we apply energy conservation theorem, which was believed to be true, then always, then, you know, we have the energy balance, then the energy of A will be shared by energy of B, will be equal to the energy of B plus energy of C. So the particle C will have a definite energy given by the difference of Ea minus Eb. So in a two-body process, we assume that the electron will have a definite energy given by the difference of the energy of these two nuclei. However, what was found was a continuous distribution of energy. So the question which arose was what happens to the conservation of energy? And people thought that maybe conservation of energy is not obeyed in this subatomic world. However, Pauli did not like that idea. So Pauli said that no, conservation of energy is true. And there is a third particle called the neutrino, which is emitted with this, which is sharing the energy. So now instead of a two-body process, I have a three-body process and the energy is shared between the neutrino and the electron. And therefore, this is a therefore the continuous energy spectrum of the electron could be explained. So as I said, it's a lepton. So we now know that due to some conservation laws among leptons, this neutrino is actually the antiparticle of the neutrino called the antineutrino. So the main thing is that this postulation of the neutrino helped in restoring the energy conservation. How, and then Enrico Fermi gave the name neutrino and he gave the theory of beta decay. And neutrino means the little neutral one in Italian. However, what are the properties of the neutrinos? It was thought that the neutrinos are massless to satisfy the conservation laws. They are chargeless. They have the same spin half, so they are fermions. And they are very, very weakly interacting. So this makes it very difficult to detect them. And they were called the ghost particle. And Pauli said that, you know, I have done something terribly wrong. I have postulated something which could never be detected. However, these two gentlemen, Fred Rhines and Clyde Cowan, proved Pauli wrong in the sense that they proved that they discovered the neutrino. So they actually proved Pauli correct and they proved Pauli's apprehensions wrong. However, this procedure took 25 years after neutrinos were postulated and it was in 1956. They used the antineutrinos produced in, you know, nuclear reactors. And they could discover the neutrinos. And for this, Nobel Prize was given to Fred Rhines in 1995. And a Nobel Prize is not given posthumously, so it could not be given to Clyde Cowan. And the Nobel lecture of Rhines is titled, the title of this slide, From Poltergeist to Particle. So neutrino as if it was a ghost. And because of this discovery, it was given a physical existence. So it really became a real particle from a ghost. So that was the title, you know, if some of you are interested, it's a very, you know, nice thing to read the Nobel lectures. I always find them very, you know, insightful. And they are not always very difficult. So, you know, you can go back and read his lecture, and, you know, a lot of history is explained at that time that, you know, they were part of the Second World War. And first they wanted the nuclear bombs to put some into some good use. And they thought that they will use the neutrinos produced there for the study for discovering the neutrinos. However, you know, that is not a controlled atmosphere. So they, later they thought of using these nuclear reactors where you have more, they could have more control over the neutrinos, and using this, they proved the existence of the neutrinos. So this is the Pauli's neutrino. As I said, it is always emitted with an electron. So it is an antineutrino which is emitted with an electron. And we know that now that each particle has its own antiparticle. So electron has its own antiparticle positron with which a neutrino is emitted, and with an electron, an antineutrino is emitted. So as I said that, you know, I introduced the site characters electron, muon, and tau, and that is because these neutrinos are always produced in accompaniment with an electron or another lepton. So neutrino is chargeless, but electron has a charge. So the neutrinos are always producing these charged leptons. So neutrinos are called neutral leptons, and neutrinos always produce charged leptons, and these charged leptons interact and give a signal for the neutrino. So the two other neutrinos that I have told, the muon neutrino and the tau neutrino, have also been discovered subsequently. So we have three types of neutrinos: the electron neutrino, which always produces an electron, the muon neutrino, which always produces a muon, and the tau neutrino, which always produces a tau. And how do we register a neutrino event? You know, how do we know? Because the neutrinos are very weakly interacting, but this, and they don't have charge, but this electron, muon, and tau, which have charge, they can help in record an event in the detector. So the question is that from where the neutrinos can come from. Now the neutrinos are what is called ubiquitous. They can come from many, many sources. The Big Bang, which has produced our universe, neutrinos are also produced, like we have the you know, microwave background photons. We also have a neutrino background. They are of very low energy of 10 to the minus 2 electron volt. So electron volt is a convenient energy in the subatomic world. And to give you an idea, average kinetic energy of air molecules is about 0.04 electron volt. And neutrinos can span energy from very low, like, you know, 0.0 10 to the minus 2 electron volt, to very high 10 to the 18 electron volt. And we also have terrestrial neutrinos, which are produced by the radioactivity inside the Earth. Then we have solar neutrinos, which are coming from the sun, supernova neutrinos, which are coming when the star dies, explodes and dies. And, you know, these are the energies. So supernova neutrino, solar neutrino, these are 10 to the 6 electron volt or MeV energy. Then we can have atmospheric neutrinos, which are GeV energy. Then we can have neutrinos for very high on energy neutrinos from galactic and extragalactic sources. And we also can have man-made neutrinos, like from nuclear reactors, which Pauli had used, which Rhines and Cowan had used. We can also have neutrinos coming from accelerators. So in this talk, I will be talking mainly about the solar, atmospheric, and also some about this galactic and extragalactic and supernova neutrinos. And you can see that they span a very high energy range, and they can give us information at several energy scales. Now, as I said, plenty of neutrinos are passing through us. These are produced in our atmosphere by the cosmic rays, the atmospheric neutrinos, the solar neutrinos, the geoneutrinos. And even a banana can produce some neutrinos, because the potassium, the radioactive decay, can produce some neutrinos. So from all these sources, about 65 million neutrinos pass through our thumbnail every second. So, you know, where we are sitting, we are bombarded with, you know, of many, many neutrinos all the time. However, the question is this: why we can't see them? And the answer is that they interact very, very weakly. So this is called an invisible particle. Like if you people have read Harry Potter's, then you know that Harry Potter used to go under an invisibility cloak and then we can't see them. So it is as if the neutrinos also have such a cloak and you know we cannot see them. And to give you some idea, to stop a neutrino, what need shielding 100 light years. So that is the time light can travel in 100 years. And for X-rays, the comparison, the length is 0.24 millimeters. So you can see that neutrinos are so very weakly interacting. So to observe them, we need some special eyes. And these special eyes are the neutrino detector. So, but these detectors have to be very, very huge because otherwise we cannot get a sufficient number of neutrino events. So this is just a cartoon that, you know, we have many neutrinos passing through us per second. And, you know, there is a chance of one interaction in 100 years. And if we have a very big detector, which is much, much bigger compared to a human size, then we can have about, you know, 300 interactions per day. And not only this, to observe these neutrinos, we have to go deep underground. And that is because this neutrino signal is very weak. So we don't want, you know, something else to confuse this signal. So we need to go to a very environment, which we call in scientific language background free, where there are no other events which will give a wrong signal as a neutrino event. And also we need observations over a large period of time. So for neutrino physicists, you have to be very patient because then only you can get enough statistics to draw some meaningful conclusions. So this is an example of a neutrino detector. This is the Super Kamiokande detector in Japan. It is the world's largest neutrino detector. And this uses 50 kiloton of water. And you can see that, you know, it is 50 and then 60. So 50 into 10 to the 6 liters of water. And it has the eyes, the special eyes that I said. These are the photomultiplier tubes and they detect the neutrinos. So the neutrinos interact with the electrons in the water or the nucleons and to produce the charged particles, and they record event in these photomultiplier tubes. There are 13,000 photomultiplier tubes here, and you can see Japanese physicists putting these photomultiplier tubes in this or repairing in this tank. So the detector is a cylindrical tank and it is 40 by 40 meters. So it's a huge detector with so much water. And it is operating since 1996, and with it can observe, you know, solar and atmospheric neutrinos. And with all such a huge size, it observes only about 30 neutrinos per day. Now, I think, I hope I have been able to convince you that it's really difficult to observe these neutrinos. It needs a lot of effort and it needs a lot of money. So then the question that will come to our mind is that why should we try to catch them? That, you know, what is the use to take up so much activities and, you know, so much trouble? There are various reasons. One thing is that they are everywhere, so you can catch them even from natural sources. Another second thing is that they can carry information from stars. By that, what we mean? As I told you, that neutrinos are very, very weakly interacting. So for instance, here I show you a photon coming from the sun, a light and a neutrino. So you can see a photon has a zigzag path, which means the photons are interacting with the solar matter and they take some time. So they get trapped because they are interacting. So they get delayed and the photon comes later, but the neutrinos can come instantaneously because they are not interacting with the solar matter. That's why the neutrinos can carry information from an earlier time than the photon. Another thing which we will see in this talk is they pose some interesting puzzles, and you know, we love solving puzzles. And when we solve puzzles and when we find the answers to these puzzles, then it will give us some, you know, new information which can be very useful in understanding the nature. So these are the several reasons for which it is useful to study the neutrinos, and all these experimental activities have taken place. So I talked about the neutrinos from the sun. So let me talk in a more little more detail about the neutrinos from the sun. So the neutrinos are needed for the sun to shine. we know that the solar fusion, there are, you know, protons fusing in the sun, which produces the heat and light. But these reactions also produce the neutrinos. So the basic reaction is where two protons collide to form a deuterium nucleus, as well another nucleus, and it emits a positron, which I said, you know, antiparticle of the electron, then a photon, and also a neutrino. Now, Hans Bethe proposed that one can study. So this was a proposal that the how the solar energy is generated. It was proposed that it is generated by these fusion reactions. Now, Hans Bethe proposed that this was in 1960s, that one can study the this hypothesis. One can test the hypothesis of energy generation in sun through the fusion reactions using the solar neutrinos. So he proposed this idea, and these two gentlemen, Davis and Bacall, I forgot to write their name here, but this is Davis and John Bacall, Raymond Davis and John Bacall, two American scientists. They said that, okay, let us do this experiment. So John Bacall was predicting the solar neutrino fluxes based on the solar model calculation. So the solar model is, you know, you have the fusion reactions, but then you have to calculate the neutrino flux, incorporating the other properties inside the sun, how the neutrinos are traveling through the sun, all these things, and the properties of the sun. So he was predicting these fluxes. And Raymond Davis was an experimentalist, and he used this reaction, you know, where a neutrino will be captured by a chlorine, and they will be, it will be emitted by an argon, it will emit an argon nucleus, 37 argon, and an electron. So what they are, their plan was to, that, you know, it was done in Homestake mine in USA. As I told you, one has to go deep underground. They took 600 tons of cleaning fluid, which contains chlorine, and they exposed this detector in the sunlight for a certain number of days. And then they will extract the argon. What determines the number of days? The observation was that, you know, the argon is a the radioactive decay of argon will give you the number of neutrinos. From the radioactive decay of argon, they can calculate the number of neutrinos. So they have to expose the material, the detector in the sun, up to the time so that argon does not decay. So it should be less than the half-life of the argon. So that was done. The neutrino, the detector was exposed to the sun. Solar neutrinos were captured. The argon was chemically extracted. And then the radioactive decay of argon gave the number of neutrinos. That's why these experiments used to be called radiochemical experiments. And with all this, they were observing actually with this big detector less than one event per day. So they declared their first result in 1968, and they found that only 1/3 of the predicted neutrinos were found. So Bacall had predicted the number of neutrinos that we expect, as I told you, but this experiment found that only 1/3 were coming. So, you know, who is taking away the neutrinos? Where are the missing neutrinos going? So there were, at that time, there were three alternatives. One is that the experiment is wrong because it is difficult to detect a handful of argon atoms. As I told you, the experiment is quite difficult. So it is difficult to detect a handful of argon atoms in that large volume. Then another alternative was that the solar model calculations of Bacall were wrong because the solar model calculation needs many inputs. And the third alternative was that the solar neutrinos are getting converted to the muon or tau neutrinos. As I have already introduced, there are three types of neutrinos. And in the sun, we are getting the electron neutrinos, and they are getting converted to muon and tau neutrinos. However, as I showed, this reaction is sensitive only to the electron neutrinos. So if mu and tau neutrinos are coming, it will miss them. So these were the three alternatives, and new experiments were planned to check these results. And there were many experiments. There was the gallium experiments, which also used a radiochemical technique and gallium. And there was this, the Super Kamiokande experiment, I told its predecessor, Kamiokande, and they were using a, so this experiment was sensitive to slightly lower energy neutrinos, solar neutrinos, and this Super Kamiokande and Kamiokande were sensitive to slightly higher energy neutrinos. They use water. So this is the summary of the experimental results without going into the details of all the experiments. See, so this is the chlorine experiment. You can see this yellow is the prediction. So this yellow, green up to this red, these are the predictions from the standard solar model calculation. And in the sun, although it is coming from a PP chain, these reactions occur in various chain reactions. So the main PP reaction, there are several chain reactions, and one has many types of neutrinos. So the 8 boron neutrinos are high energy. Then there are several other types of neutrinos. So this up to this red is the standard solar model prediction, and this black is the uncertainty in those calculations. So what happened is that you can see that even if we take the uncertainty of the solar model into account, there is a deficit because this blue is the observation. So there is a mismatch between the theoretical prediction and the deficit. Similarly, if I come to Super Kamiokande, which is this side, and Kamiokande, which is this side, they are observing only half the expected solar neutrinos. And if you go to gallium experiments, then, you know, they were assuming, they were also observing little more than half. So this is some unit called the solar neutrino unit, which is not written here. But in that unit, if 130 were expected, then they were getting about 75. So they were getting little more than half. So all the three experiments were sensitive to the electron neutrinos. And all the three experiments found that the electron neutrinos are less in number than predicted by the standard solar model. This was called the mystery of the missing solar neutrinos, or the solar neutrino problem. And it remained unsolved for 30 years. And I did my PhD on this topic. So, you know, I did my PhD around 96, I submitted. So around that time, the solar neutrino results were coming from Kamiokande, and Super Kamiokande started in 96. And so at that time, it was a very puzzling situation that why the neutrinos are missing. Finally, this problem was solved by the conclusively by the Sudbury Neutrino Observatory experiment, which is also a detector like the Super Kamiokande detector, but instead of ordinary water, it uses heavy water. And the heavy water, the advantage is that this detector can detect separately the electron type neutrino and all three types of neutrinos. So the all other detectors were sensitive only to the electron type of neutrinos, but this detector is sensitive to the electron, muon, and tau, all three neutrinos. And what did it observe? It observed 1/3 electron type neutrinos and 2/3 mu and tau neutrinos. So it said that this mu and tau neutrinos were not there in the solar, in the sun. So what did this detector prove? Then it proved that this mu and tau neutrinos are coming from the solar electron neutrinos. So the solar electron neutrinos are getting converted to other neutrinos. Another thing also it established that because if you add, then it is the total electron neutrino flux that is expected from the sun. So that it also established that the standard solar model calculations were correct, and the electrons are getting converted to some other type of neutrinos. So this is the solution of the solar neutrino problem that this experiment found, which is that neutrinos change from one type to another, and the detectors can register, the detectors which could register only one type of neutrino, the electron type of neutrino, they observed a deficit. And This conversion is called neutrino oscillation, that the neutrino, one electron type of neutrino is getting converted to the two other type of neutrino. So there is interconversion of these neutrinos. So this is a cartoon to explain this procedure. So supposing I have the electron type of neutrinos coming from the sun, and I have the electron type of neutrinos coming from the sun, and when they are propagating from the sun to Earth, they are getting intermixed. So they are produced in a pure state as an electron neutrino, but when they propagate, they are getting into a mixed state of this nu e, nu mu, and nu tau. In the language of physics, it's called a superposition state. So the pure state is not propagating, the superposition state is propagating. But when we are detecting them in the Earth, then we are again detecting a pure state. And what we are detecting is that if a detector is sensitive to the electron neutrino, then we will observe an electron neutrino only, this guy. But if the detector is sensitive to a mu and tau neutrino, then we will also observe a mu and tau neutrino. So then we can observe all three types of neutrinos. So that is what happened in the solar neutrino problem, that the solar electron neutrinos were getting converted to the muon and tau neutrinos. And this phenomenon is called neutrino oscillation, that this superposition, the propagation of the superposition state. So it is like some kind of an interference phenomena depending on the distance. So then this is the, I can show you a view graph on a video of that. So you can see this oscillation. So you can imagine that you start with a one type of ice cream, say a chocolate ice cream, which is, and then you go to some distance, and then this you get not one, but you also get two other flavors. So which is good, that you know the neutrinos, you can get various flavors. So like that, the neutrino oscillation is also a good thing, because in order to understand why this oscillation occurs, you know, we get to know some fundamental properties about neutrinos. So that's why this is useful. So apart from the sun, the neutrino oscillation is also observed from neutrinos coming from the atmosphere. So from the atmosphere, from the sun, as I said, only electron type of neutrinos were produced. But from the atmosphere, what happens is when cosmic rays heat the air, the molecules, then they produce some particles called pions, and then these pions decay and they produce these muons, which are discharged leptons, and these muons decay to produce these pions decay to produce muons and nu mus, and then muons decay to produce electron neutrinos also. So in the atmosphere, what we can get is, we can get here the nu mu is shown, but these muons can further decay to produce the electron neutrinos also. So in the atmosphere, the electron and muon type of neutrinos are produced. And actually one of the first detection of these neutrinos happened in the Kolar gold mine in India in 1965. And actually the Super Kamiokande detector found that they were also sensitive to the atmospheric neutrinos, and they found that the atmospheric muon neutrinos are getting converted to tau neutrinos. So Super Kamiokande also observed neutrino oscillation of oscillation. And these results were, the solar neutrino results were later confirmed by a reactor experiment in Japan, and the Super Kamiokande results were later confirmed by several accelerator-based neutrino experiments. So these are man-made sources. So the neutrino oscillation, the fact that the neutrinos oscillate, is established. And as I said, that neutrino oscillation, you know, why neutrino oscillations occur. And if we go deeper into the phenomenon to understand why it occurs, why there is this superposition of the states which evolve, then we understand that it requires neutrinos to have mass. Now, when Pauli postulated the neutrino, then he said that the neutrinos are massless or there can be very small mass. However, you know, there was no definite proof of that neutrinos have mass. However, these oscillation experiments established that neutrinos have mass. And in order to understand the generation of neutrino mass, that why we have neutrino mass, one needs to go beyond what we already know. And it is still an unresolved problem. So the you know, that why neutrino mass is there, to understand that we have to go beyond our standard ideas. Therefore, this is a very important topic, that why neutrino mass comes, because it can help us know more information than what we already know. And because of this, it's no surprise that in 2015, Nobel Prize in Neutrino Oscillation was awarded to Takaki Kajita of University of Tokyo in Japan, and Arthur MacDonald of Queen's University, Canada. He was from the Sudbury Neutrino Observatory Collaboration, and Kajita was from the Super Kamiokande Collaboration. And the Nobel citation rate for the discovery of neutrino oscillation, which shows that neutrinos have mass. So this was a very, very important discovery, and therefore the Nobel Prize was awarded to them. Now, you know, although we know that there is neutrino oscillation and we have some idea of what could be the neutrino masses, there are still many properties of about neutrinos which we don't know. And then there are many detectors which are planned in the worldwide now for studying further neutrino properties. And in this, the India-based neutrino observatory is the Indian proposal. And this is a 50 kiloton magnetized iron detector. And this is sensitive to the atmospheric neutrinos. And they can observe oscillations of atmospheric neutrinos. And it can discover unknown neutrino properties, which are not yet known. And this was the site in Theni district in Tamil Nadu. And of course, you know, this idea was there in 2002 when these new results from Sudbury came. And at that time, this proposal started. However, there were many problems because, you know, there were environmental concerns. So the site had to be changed, and there were a lot of roadblocks due to the concern from experimentalists. Not all of them are well-founded, because they said that the neutrino, for instance, could be harmful. But as I told that, you know, neutrinos are, you know, very mild, very weakly interacting. If they can pass through us, we will not even know. So they are not at all harmful. And the atmospheric neutrinos are already passing through all these sites, and they are coming for free. So it was a wonderful opportunity to start something using atmospheric neutrinos. India was one of the first experiments in Kolar Gold Field to detect the atmospheric neutrinos. But there were some roadblocks, but this is a very competitive proposal to study neutrino properties. So now, apart from the solar and the atmospheric neutrinos, Super Kamiokande detector also observed neutrinos from an exploding star, which is called a supernova. So for very high mass stars, when they die, then they die with something called a supernova explosion. So, you know, there is energy generation by nuclear processes, and that is balanced by the gravitational pull. However, after this nuclear energy generation stops, when very heavy nucleus like iron is produced, then this gravitational collapse cannot be resisted, and there is a fall, and then an explosion occurs, and this is called a supernova explosion. That's how massive stars die. And a supernova 1987A exploded in a galaxy called Large Magellanic Cloud. This was the star called Sandulake 69202. And the Super Kamiokande detector, and also there was another detector called IMB, they observed few supernova events in 1987. Now, the supernova explosion mechanism says that 99% of supernova energy is released in the neutrinos. And this observation established that theory. And there were very few events. However, still a lot of conclusions could be drawn. And this was, you know, a chance discovery. Like, they did not know that, you know, that this is going to come. But this gave us a lot of information. And this observation of solar and supernova neutrinos started a new field called the neutrino astronomy. And in fact, 2002 Nobel Prize was awarded to Raymond Davies of Homestake Collaboration and Masatoshi Koshiba of the Kamiokande Collaboration, which was the predecessor of Super Kamiokande. So this collaboration got two Nobel Prizes. One is Koshiba for Kamiokande and one is Kajita for Super Kamiokande. And it was for pioneering contribution to astrophysics, in particular for detection of cosmic neutrinos. So this observation of solar and supernova neutrinos started the field of neutrino astronomy. And right now, a very popular field is the multi-messenger astronomy, which is detecting astrophysical objects in more than one signals, and neutrinos can also play an important part in it. So what happens is that if I have a, if I have an object which is any distance, any astrophysical object, then how to study them? They can emit gamma rays, they can emit cosmic rays, there are gravitational waves, but there are also neutrinos. So the multi-messenger astronomy is to study astrophysical object through several sources, for instance, cosmic rays, gamma rays, neutrinos, and they can give us complementary information. As I said earlier, that neutrinos can arrive directly from region from where light cannot come. So you can see that neutrino is coming straight. Gamma ray is, breaking into other particles, and cosmic ray is bending because these are charged particles. So they are in the magnetic fields, but neutrinos have no charge. So they don't bend in a magnetic field. So neutrinos can provide some complementary information. And the Ice Cube Neutrino Telescope, which is the coolest telescope in the world. This is a very major player in this neutrino astronomy. So this is situated in South Pole, and this is a gigaton detector. So the idea was to detect very high energy neutrinos. So the atmospheric neutrinos that we detected in Super Kamiokande were of GeV energy. And as we go to very high energy, then and if they are coming from much distant sources, the flux will be much less. So one needs a much larger volume. So a wonderful idea came into the mind of physicists that why not use the ice? Because the ice, it's like a water, but there is a large volume of ice. So they could build a cubic kilometer gigaton detector. So this is the Ice Cube laboratory, and they have this inside the ice. This is the ice top, and this is their ice top observatory. This is they call the Ice Cube lab, and they have these strings which have optical sensors. And this is a kilometer cube, and you can see that this is the Eiffel Tower. So you can see that how big this detector is. And this observed the highest energy neutrinos from distant astrophysical objects in 2013. So this is a peta electron volt. So this is 10 to the 15 electron volt. So if we go back to the neutrino flux, that neutrino sources that we have seen, then we can see that Ice Cube is here, 10 to the 15. So this is galactic or even extragalactic neutrinos coming from outside. So these were the neutrinos that Ice Cube could detect. So it started in 2011, and the first neutrino was detected in 2013. So this is how Ice Cube detector works. So there is a neutrino coming. It will interact with the nucleus or the electron, and it will create the charged particle. And as you can see here, this sensor will, just a second. These sensors will light up. So the neutrino will light up the sensors, and that's how event is recorded. So this is the ice observatory, and this is the neutrinos from space, and this is how they are detected. And as I said already, they detected the first time in 2013. So these are some Ice Cube events. They have very nice names, like depending on these energetics, they can determine the energy of the neutrinos. They gave names on the Sesame Street characters like Bert and Ernie and Big Bird. So they have observed now many events. So one of the very important events here is this event, which is called IC170922. So this neutrino in 2017, they had this neutrino. And then they sent alert to. So the point is that, you know, when the Ice Cube is detecting these events, for instance, these events, Bart and Ernie or Big Bird, then could they determine what is the source? Apart from detecting the high energy neutrinos, one of the objectives of Ice Cube was to find out from which source these neutrinos are coming. However, you know, it needs some kind, you have to precisely point towards the source. So it needs something called an angular resolution. So they do something called a sky map to point out the source. However, in these cases, they could not do it. And when in 2017, they have the event. So the event is like this, as you can see that this is the this is 3000 nanoseconds and this is the starting and this is the end. And this event, when they found, then they sent alert to all the other telescopes. And the Fermi telescope of NASA, it is a gamma ray telescope, and the MAGIC telescope in Canary Island in Spain, they found some correlation with a flaring blazar. So blazar is some distant galaxy which is powered by some black holes, and they emit radiation. So what they found is that these blazars, the intensity of these blazars became higher around the same time when Ice Cube sent them the alert. So they could do a joint study and could correlate the source of these high energy neutrinos as a flaring blazar, which has this name. So this was the first ever identification of a likely source of high energy neutrinos. And this started the era of multi-messenger astronomy with neutrinos. So, you know, I come to the end of the talk now. So this is the neutrino story. It started with the impossible dream of Pauli. He postulated the neutrino. He said that only who dares to dream wins, and he was a winner. He is a winner. And you know it. And now we have reached the unreachable stars with Ice Cube. This is this blazar, and the Ice Cube could point that the neutrinos are Ice Cube in correlation with Fermi and gamma magic. Could point towards a source, so it could reach an unreachable star for the neutrinos. And what will be the take-home message? The take-home message will be that neutrinos are all around us, but they interact very, very weakly. That's why we can't feel them. And one needs huge detectors to study them. And they have fascinating properties. They can carry information from stars. Studying their properties give us understanding of the fundamental particles, and it helps us to go beyond our standard ideas, and that may hold the key to a deeper understanding of the nature. In the past year, starting from the experiment of Ray Davis in 1968, we have learned a lot about the neutrinos. However, the story is not yet over. And there are many new experiments which are coming, and which can help us in knowing the neutrino properties that we still don't know. Also, the multi-messenger astronomy with neutrinos is a very new field, and it will help us to probe the universe. So the title of my talk was originated from this poem, and I thought that this is a very, very good. These are very good lines for the time that we are going through. That and for also for scientific pursuit, that to dream the impossible dream, to fight the unbeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow. This is my quest, to follow that star, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far, still strove with his last ounce of courage to reach the unreachable star. So the scientific pursuit has to start from dreams, and then only we can reach the unreachable stars. So I hope I have been able to instill that in you, and I would like to thank you all. The many resources I have taken from internet, and everyone should stay safe and stay positive. Not all invisible particles are as harmless as neutrinos, so we must be always wearing our masks when we are going out. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Shubhavati. Such a wonderful talk, and what a beautiful poem. Thank you so much. Would you be now willing to take some questions?
Yes, sure.
Yeah. So Anupam, will you
coordinate? Yes. Sure. Thank you for the wonderful talk, Professor Shubhavati. I'll now move on to the Q&A section, and you can have some water also.
Yeah.
I must say that this talk has been attended by many people, close to 175 on YouTube live stream and close to 100 on Zoom. So there are many questions, and we won't be able to address all of them. So let me start with the first question.
Anupam, you can give my email address to people if they want to ask me directly.
Sure, we will share it with you. With those unattended questions, we'll share the question with you. So, first question is by Vandana Manchanda. She's asking, what is the mass of electron neutrino, and what happens if neutrino and neutrino collide with each other?
So, you know, we do not yet know the absolute mass of the neutrino. So, as I said, neutrino oscillation establishes that neutrinos have mass, but because, you know, neutrino oscillation is an interference phenomena, it can probe, you know, if you know interference, then in interference we can probe a phase difference. And in neutrino oscillation, the mass difference, the difference of the masses, as I told here, that you know, here, as I told you, I have a pure state, but when the neutrinos propagate, they are not pure states, and these are called the mass states. And what we can measure is the difference between these masses. So the difference between these masses, you know, act as a phase difference. So the neutrino oscillation experiment can give us only difference between the masses. And we know two mass squared differences. One is 10 to the minus 5 eV squared, and one is 10 to the minus 3 eV squared. Now, there is some direct measurement from beta decay on the neutrino mass, and there is a recent result has come from the Katrin experiment. And they measure of the order of, you know, they say a bound that the mass of the electron neutrino is, say, less than 1 electron volt or something like that. Katrin has a new result. I exactly don't remember what exactly that was, but say of the order of 1 electron volt. But that is a bound that you say that neutrino has to be less than this mass. And the oscillation experiment said that neutrinos have this kind of mass squared difference. And coming to your second question, yes, neutrinos can interact with the neutrinos. And, you know, that is called the self-interaction of the neutrinos. And the self-interaction of neutrinos is very important when you have a dense atmosphere. For instance, you know, when we consider the early universe, or when we consider the supernova, there this self-interaction of neutrinos play important role to alter certain properties. So they can, but you know, if we need a very high density to study the self-interaction of neutrinos.
Thank you, Professor, for the answer. Next question is by Sushil, a related question. He's asking, neutrinos being particles, do they not collide with atomic particles and lose momentum?
So yes, neutrinos, you see, if you see here, for instance, you know, if you see the ice cube here, here you see neutrinos are interacting with some nucleus, and it is producing another charged particle. So they can have various types of interaction. There can be interactions, you know, where a neutrino is, like, for instance, you know, I showed you this chlorine reaction where the neutrino is absorbed and it is giving us an electron. There can be scattering reaction when a neutrino scatters with an electron, produces a neutrino and another electron. For instance, in super Kamiokande, we have that reaction. So that kind of reactions happen and through which we observe the neutrinos. Whether they will lose energy or whether they will not lose energy will depend on, you know, what kind of reaction it is. If it is inelastic, then it will lose energy. If it is elastic, then it will not lose energy. It will depend on the energy of the neutrino. So very high energy neutrinos will lose their energy. And so this will depend on the energy of the neutrinos.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for the answer, Professor. So the next question is, the name is not clear, but he wants to know, ma'am, difference between electron neutrino, muon neutrino, and tau neutrino. And he wants the explanation of the continuity in the beta decay graph. And are there any peaks due to neutrino hypothesis? Please explain, ma'am. So yeah, this is the question.
Okay, first let me tell the beta decay, okay?
Yes, yes.
Now in beta decay, you can see that, you know, if I have, supposing I have two particles emitted, then what will be the energy of C? Energy of C will be EB minus EA. So that is the fixed energy. So a fixed energy means I would have a line. It is not exactly a line because of, you know, I can have a thermal temperature because of which it can be slightly broad, but I have a fixed energy. But here I have a continuous energy. Now, if I have another particle here, then what happens is that the neutrino and the electron will share the energy. So when supposing this energy is less than this EB minus EC and this other part, so supposing I have my EB minus EC is somewhere here, then the zero, so you know I have zero energy of the electron here, so this is the, this will be then the energy of the neutrino. So it will go like that, that you know that the energy is shared. So the I have the continuous spectrum. That is because the if I add the energy of the electron and the neutrino, then I will get the EB minus EA. Now, depending on this, depending on the mass of the neutrino, and that's how actually I said this experiment which measures the neutrino electron mass, there can be a small peak where the, you know, if we assume that there is a mass of the neutrino. So this is something called a Curie plot. If you read beta decay calculation, then you will find that it will depend, there is a dependence on the mass. So there can be a small peak depending on where the mass is. And in fact, from there, these direct detection experiments can measure the neutrino mass. So the direct detection experiment means they are doing the beta decay of, and from the tritium decay, they are observing the neutrino mass. So from there they can. But here what happens is that you can, if the conservation of energy is violated, not established by, you have a B plus C plus D, then your EB minus EA will be shared by C and D. So you will have a EC plus ED. So in everywhere, you have to sum the energy of the electron and the energy of the neutrino to get this EB minus EA. So I think that was the first question. What was the second question?
Yeah, the difference between neutrino and electron.
You know, as I said, that they come, they are called a lepton family. Now the point is that why should we group them like this, right? Is like we just cannot group them. We have to have some have something which will guide us that we have to group them. And this question, actually, you know, the question that you ask was raised first when the electron neutrino was discovered, Pauli's neutrino, then muon was there from cosmic rays, muon was discovered. then people said that, and you know, the pions will emit the muons and the neutrino. Then this question arose that whether this neutrino is same as the electron neutrino or it's a different neutrino. And that experiment was carried out by Lederman and his collaborators, and it actually got a Nobel Prize. And they found that, you know, they found that this, if you allow the pions to decay and you have a detector which is which will be sensitive to muons but not to electrons, then what will happen is that, you know, which will be sensitive to muon neutrinos and not electron neutrinos, it will record some muon neutrino event. But and if you it is sensitive to only electron neutrinos, then it will not record any event. So the point is that when muon, this particle muon decays, then it gives a different type of neutrino that was established in the experiment. And that's why this lepton number, you know, muon lepton number was assumed that a muon will always decay, will give a new mu. Or conversely, if a new mu interacts, it will give a muon neutrino. Or a new tau interacts, it will give a tau neutrino. Although we don't see the neutrinos, we can see the mu and the tau and the electron. And their properties are different. So from that, we can say that these neutrinos are different.
Okay. Thank you, Professor. A related question, Kiran is asking, are neutrinos in quantum entanglement with their respective muon, tau, and electron counterparts?
Actually, no. See, the neutrino oscillation, you know, quantum entanglement of neutrinos, people have studied, but these are separate because these are quite much higher mass than the neutrinos, no? Electron, muon, and tau. So there is no quantum entanglement of the neutrinos with the electron, muon, and tau.
Thank you. I'll move on to the next question by Shruti Agrawal. Since there are several sources of neutrino, how are we sure that we are detecting only solar neutrinos? And a related question by Devesh Pra.
Yeah.
How do we distinguish between neutrino from different sources? How we exactly get to know if a neutrino is a solar, cosmic, or from any other source?
This is a, you know, very, very good question. I didn't show any plot, but I can explain to you. You know, for instance, first of all, you can see that the solar neutrinos are of MeV energy, right? And the atmospheric neutrinos are of GeV energy. So you have, you know, when you have different energy neutrinos, then different reactions are triggered. For instance, the super camiocandid detector, they will have a different reaction triggered and a different signal for the solar neutrinos than the atmospheric neutrinos. So for the solar neutrinos, the reaction is the neutrino electron scattering reaction. So a neutrino will scatter with the electron in water and will give another neutrino and an electron. That is first of all thing. Second is that actually this detector, camiocandid and super camiocandid, can can measure the direction of the neutrinos. Unlike the experiment of Davis, which I explained, in that which is not a real-time experiment. In the Davis experiment, you expose the detector in the sun for say a number of days, and then you chemically extract the argon. In super camiocandid or camiocandid experiment, a neutrino from the sun will come and hit the detector. So an event is recorded. So you can measure the direction of the neutrinos. So you can measure, and actually, you know, super camiocandid measured or camiocandid, they measured and they showed a peaking towards the theta direction of the angle towards the sun. So they had that resolution that they could show that they are the solar neutrinos. Now for atmospheric neutrinos, these are the GeV neutrinos. They are coming from all directions. And, you know, there are no other neutrinos which are really the GeV neutrinos. And then we know that what kind of interactions they will have. And, you know, we will have what kind of flux because they are coming from all directions. Then for atmospheric neutrinos, some neutrinos are passing through the Earth and some neutrinos are passing through a shorter distance, right? Because they are coming, you know, down and up. So if you have a, is it clear? So if you have this Earth, say, then some neutrinos will coming from down and some neutrinos will pass through the distance. So all over this Earth, you will have neutrinos coming. And So you can measure that, you know, how many neutrinos are coming, and you have a prediction with which you compare. Even with that only, you said that there is a, people could say that there is an oscillation. However, one can measure this isotropic flux. So they, and there are no other GeV flux. So from there, one can, like, there are, you know, some trapped neutrinos in the sun, dark matter, which can give, there are some conjectures, but two things are considered mainly. One is energy and one is the direction. So this is something my daughter had drawn, and it was just in the, happened to be on the table. So I think it was useful.
Yeah, of course. Yes. thank you. Thank you, Professor, for the answer. So we'll move on to the next question by Priyabrata. So he's asking how neutrino can be assumed as a potential contributor to the matter and antimatter symmetry. And his next question is how neutrino detection is helpful in the study of stellar evolution.
Okay, very good. You're asking me very good questions, and I have not talked about it. I was under the impression that, you know, people are not knowing about neutrinos so much. So I have not discussed about this matter antimatter thing at all, but you know, it is connected to the neutrino properties. So what I will try to explain, if I can, from whatever I have, as I told you, know that these neutrinos, when they propagate, they go into a mixed state, which is called a superposition of states. Now I talked about neutrino mass, but you know, this superposition of states, you can see that each state has different proportion of the neutrinos, right? These are electron, muon, and tau neutrinos. They occur in different proportions. And these different proportions or different mixings are called the mixing angles. You know, when you do a little bit of more mathematics of this, then you can see that this mixing angles can be parameterized by a matrix. And that matrix is a, in general, a complex matrix, and it can have a phase, which is called a, which is a complex phase. And if there is a complex phase, then, you know, it is different for neutrinos and antineutrinos. So the idea is that if this complex phase is anyway responsible for the matter and antimatter asymmetry, which is observed. Now, a matter and antimatter asymmetry is observed. And, you know, we talked about the elementary particles called neutrino leptons, but there are other elementary particles called quarks. And, you know, we have a model called a standard model. And in the standard model, we have an explanation of this matter-antimatter asymmetry, but it is not sufficient to generate the observed matter-antimatter asymmetry. Therefore, additional sources are required. Now, in quark sector also, we have a complex phase, which is helpful in explaining the matter-antimatter asymmetry. Therefore, when neutrino oscillation was established, then it was asked that whether there can be a complex phase which is responsible for the matter-antimatter asymmetry. And recently, some neutrino experiments about whom I did not discuss, like T2K or NOVA in Japan and US, they have given some results that there indeed may be a non-zero complex phase. So it can be related perhaps, but you know, it's not at all clear. There is no quantitative model is there, because we don't even know how neutrino mass is generated. But there are many models where you can do, so it is model dependent, where you can do a quantitative study of these things. But it is mainly because of this CP phase and the mass. So this phase, complex phase, is called CP phase, and and because of the neutrino mass and mixing. So that is the first question. Then second question was?
How neutrino detection is helpful in studying stellar evolution?
Yeah, so you see, like I, as I showed, this stellar evolution reaction is there. It is predicting some amount of neutrinos and photons. Now, you know, this is a proton-proton. You see the cycle. I have just shown the main reaction, but because it's a nuclear reaction, it will occur through various chains. You know, the proton-proton will give you something, then that reaction will fuse with something, give another higher nucleus, like that it goes. So then you can calculate the neutrino flux. And if you measure the neutrino flux, and if you get the correct neutrino flux, then you can say that, you know, these stellar evolution reactions that we have that we have predicted is correct. Now, those reactions are based on the nuclear physics and weak interaction. But on the other hand, you know, how much flux is emitted, that we don't know. So neutrino flux, and that is predicted by models. And that was measured in the neutrinos by the Sudbury Neutrino Observatory detector for some neutrinos called the 8 boron. So as I showed here, there can be 8 boron neutrinos, PP neutrinos. So the Sudbury Neutrino Observatory measured the 8 boron neutrino flux, and it was the same as the standard solar model predicted. And the standard solar model was based on the stellar evolution. So first of all, it measured that the standard solar model gave the correct flux. And when you observe the neutrinos, then you know that, you know, the stellar, the fusion reactions, which were supposed to be the backbone of the stellar evolution theory. Oh, you asked about stellar evolution.
Yes, I think he meant how detecting the neutrinos help us study stellar evolution. Yeah.
Okay. So then stellar evolution, if we think of, then, you know, the how will a star evolve? Finally, it goes to a supernova explosion. Okay. So the supernova explosion, the supernova explosion theory said that 99%, 1% is emitted in photons and 99% in neutrinos. And just excuse me. So when, you know, that was observed, the supernovas, then, you know, that supported the supernova explosion through neutrinos. So in that way, you can see that the supernova explosion mechanism, what was thought of, was supported by this.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Professor. In fact, you mentioned that the multi-messenger astronomy era is also adding to information about it. Yeah. So I'll move on to the next question by Ruta Prabhu Das, and he's asking, ma'am, should every particle has to have their antiparticle, and why?
Yes, every particle, all the fundamental particles have their antiparticle. And how to explain why? Okay, one thing I can say that it was observed. Another thing I can say that, you know, if you do something called a quantum mechanics or quantum field theory, then you can see that, you know, the theory will require them. So for instance, the antiparticles was proposed initially that, you know, when we considered the relativistic particles, the theory of relativistic particles, we tried to study the quantum mechanics of relativistic particles. Then we were seeing that to have consistent theory, we needed some negative energy particles. And then later they were interpreted as the antiparticles. And then they were observed. So theoretically, they are needed to have a consistent theory, and they are also observed.
Okay, thank you for the answer. Next question is, I'm not sure if it's a correct, but then I'll ask. So unlike a free neutron, a free proton does not decay. Why is it so?
You know, like proton will decay to what? Like it will depend on that. There are theories where, you know, the proton can indeed decay. And these are called the grand unified theories. But the proton decay, that is not observed. In fact, it's a good that you ask, because, you know, this Kamiokande experiment, this was actually called the Kamioka nucleon decay experiment. So one of the conjectures was that you know that in these theories which are beyond our standard theories, there the proton can decay. So this was called the Kamioka nucleon decay experiment. But if you consider ordinary proton, then, you know, there are conservation laws which will not let the proton decay. But there are theories where the proton can decay, and this Kamioka experiment started to observe that. But this, it has not, so far it has not been observed.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Professor, for the answer. Alok is asking, is there any upcoming programs to detect neutrinos in India?
Yeah, this was this India-based neutrino observatory that I mentioned. And it is upcoming for a long time. So I hope it will come. And you know, this is this magnetized detector in South India near Madurai. And it can observe the atmospheric neutrinos. And so this is the energy range, you know. So you have to optimize a detector. When I say a detector, then you have to optimize it for its energy. And so this is the atmospheric neutrinos to which this detector is sensitive to. And we really hope it's come. It has a lot of good physics possibilities. And you know, like it would be a made in India project. And when we do neutrino oscillation data analysis, like we work on this, and we really felt that having our own experiment would be really good, because you know, you have access to all the data and all that. And I would say that I, you know, had a graduate training program. We had various students who graduated from here, many students, and India is also part of other programs in the neutrino programs in the world. For instance, there is a DUNE program in Fermilab, accelerator based, and we are part of that also. And our students are, after graduating from INO, they are in all these super like T2K or DUNE collaboration. They are getting postdoctoral fellowships there. So, you know, science is international. And so in that way, it is there. But it would have been really good, because this has a lot of physics potential, and it has generated a lot of physics in neutrino physics in India. Like when I started doing neutrino physics back in 92, 93, there were not many people doing, but now there are a lot of people doing. So I believe that INO has generated a lot of neutrino programs in India. And we are also taking part in worldwide activities, but we are hoping that INO will come.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor. So there are many questions related to this one. So the question is, why we use water in neutrino observatory and why these observatories are underground?
So water is basically because, you know, it's cheap. It is easily available. So that is one of the idea of using water. And why it is underground? Because as I said that, you know, what is happening, a neutrino, say, is producing a muon. Now your cosmic rays can directly also give you muons. So, and neutrino is very feeble interacting particle. So what happens is that, you know, you will get a, you will not know. So for instance, you know, when we, so you have to make many special arrangements to get the neutrino flux. So this in scientific term is called, we have a, something called a signal, and then we have something called a background, right? So now the thing is that if you want to measure something which is very weakly interacting, then it will give very weak signal. And you, if you have events coming from the background, you know, from some other sources, then there can be a problem. I want to detect the event which is coming from the neutrino. So I have the cosmic rays, they're producing neutrinos, but cosmic rays are directly producing muons also, for instance, for the Super Kamiokande. So I don't want those muons to be confused as a signal. And you know, that's why I told that one went to South Pole was one of the reasons, was, you know, that huge volume was available for free. So.
Okay, thank you. So a related question is, how does heavy water detect all three types of neutrinos, but not normal water?
Because heavy water has deuterium, and in deuterium there can be a reaction which is called, you know, which is the same for the all the three neutrinos. Can I stop here and show another one? Is it
yes? Okay? Yes.
Because these questions are coming, and I have the. Is it showing?
Not yet. You'll have to share the screen.
Ah, okay. Sorry. Yeah.
what is that? Sorry.
Yes, now we can see the slides.
Okay, so you see that, you know, we can have in water, these neutrinos were interacting with the electron and they were giving neutrino electron going to another neutrino and an electron. So that I can show you what was the reaction in the neutrino, okay? Detector. See here, a neutrino is coming and interacting with an electron and it will give another electron. Or it will interact with the nucleus for atmospheric and give a muon and electron. But when it goes to, then you know, you have a deuteron which is a neutron and proton. Then it can give a reaction which is called a, you know, in which there will be electron and proton and proton and another where all three will take place. So, you know, this will be a neutrino, neutron, proton. So a neutron proton is going to neutron proton. This is called something like a, you know, so I don't have any charge change here, right? A proton is giving me a proton, a neutron is giving me a neutron and a neutrino. But if you see this reaction, then you can see an electron is coming. So a proton, here the neutron is getting converted. I have two protons and one electron. So it is charge changing. Now, if I have a muon neutrino, then the muon neutrino has to have a muon. Then only it can have this reaction. So this reaction takes place only for the electron neutrino. Similar thing happens. In fact, for the water, actually the nu mu can scatter, the superchemiconda actually can see another, okay. The superchemiconda sees here the neutrino electron, the water, I have a neutrino electron scattering. There also the other two type of neutrinos can take part, but not with the same strength. The nu mu and the nu tau interaction with the electron has a less strength than the interaction of the nu e with the electron. But in this case, in Sudbury, the neutral current, because this charge is not changing here, all the three neutrinos take part with equal strength. And that is just because of this mechanism of the reaction, which is charge, this reaction, because I have this neutron proton and I have this possibility of this reaction. But in neutrino electron scattering, I will have a neutrino electron going to a neutrino electron. I can have it in two ways, but you know, the nu mu and the nu tau will have a less strength. That's why superchemiconda, they were sensitive to nu mu and nu tau. I didn't get into the details, but it was not with equal strength. That's why they could not detect the nu mu and the nu tau. They could not separately detect the nu mu and the nu tau, but because they, but here, because they have two kind of diagnostics, one is they call the charge current reaction and one is they call the neutral current reaction. Charge current is only sensitive to nu e and they are sensitive to all three. So they could compare these two. Superchemiconda did not have the possibility of comparing these two and separating the neutrino electron scattering into these two. Although to some extent, there was a process of the nu mu and the nu tau electric interacting with the electrons. Don't know if it is clear, but
yeah. So thank you. I'll move on to the next question. There are many questions related to neutron oscillations. I'll read one. Siddharth Jain is asking, shouldn't oscillations also occur like neutrinos? Shouldn't oscillations also occur between other leptons?
Oh, because you know, the This is because it is related to your mass. The other leptons have so high mass, your oscillation wavelength is related to your mass. For instance, if you consider some, for instance, a football, it is not oscillating, right? So here, although we are going to the subatomic particles, the other leptons have mass is so high that you can there you cannot observe these oscillations.
Thank you. Abhirishi is asking, ice cube neutrino detection is how sensitive? Is it sensitive, more sensitive than the water detection?
Ice cube, you know, it is sensitive to high energy neutrinos, higher energy neutrinos. So they are like ice cube is also water. It is ice, but ice cube detector has more sensitivity to, yes, it has more sensitivity to measure the energy of the neutrinos. Because, you know, it will depend on also your detector design and, you know, all on your algorithm of how can you reconstruct the events. So ice cube, if you consider these high energy neutrinos, then the water detector is not sensitive to these high energy neutrinos. Ice cube is more sensitive to this.
Okay, thank you. I'll move on to a little lighter question by Bhavya. Almost we are at the end of the event, but anyways, depending on your availability, we can extend. Bhavya is asking, ma'am, what is the difference between experimental and theoretical neutrino physics? Exactly what does a theoretical neutrino physicist work on?
Okay, that's very good. First of all, you know, we are guided by experiment. Now, in a theoretical neutrino physics field, like, you know, we have these experiments. These experiments, oscillation experiments, have given us, established that the neutrinos have some tiny mass. Now, theoretically, we need to find what is the theory that gives us a neutrino mass. So far in particle physics, what we have is something called a standard model. This is a symmetry-based approach, but this is a model which has been experimentally verified. But the standard model does not have neutrino mass. So those who are doing theoretical neutrino physics, they are trying to see that what is the neutrino mass, or, you know, I talked about this neutrino. Someone asked about the matter-antimatter asymmetry due to the neutrinos. So what are the possibilities of, you know, neutrino masses? For instance, I talked about proton decay and grand unified theories. In grand unified theories, the neutrino mass can come generated. So in theoretically, we work on those things. However, when we give a theory or we give a model which will explain the neutrino mass, then we have to explain the mass that has been observed by the experiments. So that's where the theory and the experiment have to have an interface or have to have a marriage, or they have to talk to each other. So you can have a theory, but which is not explaining any experimental data, then that theory will not be accepted. So if I have a neutrino mass model or a theory which is not able to explain the experimental data, then that model will be disfavored. But that model will be ruled out. It goes like that.
Thank you. Professor Avinash is asking if you would comment on relic neutrinos or cosmic neutrino background and its experimental confirmation, if any.
Actually, there is no experimental confirmation of that. So, you know, as I showed that, but theoretically, you know that, you know, indirect proof is there. So this Big Bang produces the neutrino, you know about the microwave background, and like that, there is a cosmic neutrino background, but this is because this is very small energy here. So cosmic microwave background, you know, I have the photon temperature about 3 Kelvin, but cosmic neutrino background temperature is 2 Kelvin. So they are second most abundant particle, but there is indirect proof of their existence, but there is no direct detection.
Thank you. So there are many questions about the velocity of a neutrino. Is what's the velocity of a neutrino, or what's the velocity ranges of a neutrino? Many people have asked this question.
It's the same as the speed of light.
Okay, thank you. So there was
some experiment, you know, a few years back, which said that neutrinos are traveling more than the speed of light, but that experimental result could not be established.
Thank you. So the information, there was a graph that you showed of various energetic neutrinos. So the speed of the neutrino remains the same, but maybe how do we know that the energy is higher of these neutrinos?
The energy will be, it's a relativistic thing, no? So the energy will be related to the process which is producing it. And so, for instance, you know, high energy, have these many high energy particles for, like, for instance, if you have blazers which are powered by black holes, then you have many high energy particles. So they are producing higher energy neutrinos.
Okay. Thank you, Professor. So I will end the talk with the last question maybe, but there are several other questions related. So there are many questions about neutrino oscillations. People want to know what causes this oscillations and basically the physics of the neutrino oscillations. There are several questions related to the neutrino oscillations. Okay. It seems to be a very interesting topic for people. Yeah.
So, you know, this I thought was a slightly higher. And so, you know, you remember I showed you this superposition. So what happens is that, you know, supposing if they are not massless and they have particles of finite mass, then I have these two states, a nu mu, nu tau. They will be superposition of light and heavy states. So what I am saying here is that the pure states which are produced, say, in the sun or in the atmosphere in some process, they are not the states which are propagating. And when they are propagating, a superposition state is I think I should say it in a little different way. The states which are, you know, this light and heavy, these are the states of definite mass. And this pure flavor state is actually a mixture of these mass states. Okay. Now, if you have a light state and a heavy state, and then if you time evolve in vacuum, or, you know, if you go through a certain distance, in particle physics, the time and distance are in equivalent unit, then you have that, you know, then the heavier part will fall behind and the lighter part will go ahead, right? That is what we know. So what will happen is that this will give rise to a phase difference. So what happens is that certain linear combination of the light and heavy state made a pure nu mu state at the source. But when you come at the detector at a later time, that combination is lost. And this theta is the mixing angle, which I told. So as a result, what happens is that you find a state which is a mixture of state. So this is like a phase difference, right? Now, if you remember your high school waves, you know, then, and you have two waves which have a phase difference, then you combine these two waves and you can have a pattern, which is called the interference pattern if there is a certain phase difference. So like that, it happens here also that if neutrinos have mass, then at birth, there is a certain proportion of this light and heavy states, which makes it a nu mu. When it travels, then it evolves in time differently. And at a later time, it becomes a different proportion. So that is the basic physics of neutrino oscillation. If you calculate the probability, then you will find, so what you have to do is you have to calculate the probability that what is the probability that a nu mu is getting converted to nu tau. And it is very easy. You have to have some basic quantum mechanics, how these light and heavy states are evolving in vacuum. And then you can get this kind of a pattern that, you know, initial neutrino versus the length and the energy. So it will depend on your length and the energy that, you know, what is the mass difference to which the neutrino oscillation can occur. So if I have a distance, the solar neutrinos and the atmospheric neutrinos, they have different length and energy. So they will give us different phase differences, which are related to the mass differences of the neutrinos. So basically, this is some quantum mechanical interference phenomena.
Okay. Thank you, Professor, for the answer. Would you like to add more to that? Or
I think that at this stage, it is difficult for me to add more
yes,
to that.
Yes, sure.
And I can add little more that, you know, this is kind of a superposition state which is produced. What one does is this light and heavy, they evolve in time. Why it changes? Because these states are states which are evolving with time, not these states. So when we evolve these states with time, then what you have to do is that, you know, you have to calculate the amplitude after a certain time, that, you know, what is the amplitude of a new mu getting converted to new tau. So if you know quantum mechanics, then I have a brand new mu and a kth new tau, and I will calculate that amplitude. And then you can calculate the oscillation probability. We will see it will depend on your mass spread difference, and it will depend on this mixing angle. It's very easy to do it for two flavors. And then, you know, one can do it, you know, there are three neutrinos, so one can do for three flavors.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for the answer, Professor Shobhapathy. And thank you for the wonderful talk and taking your time to answer so many questions. There's still more questions, which we would convey to you, and if you have time to answer those, that would be great. So with that, I would ask Rukmini to share her thoughts, and thank you once again, Professor.
Thank you so much, Shobhapathy, for this wonderful talk and very interesting question answer session. I had one quick question. A massless particle travels at the speed of light, but I didn't know a massive particle, however small is the mass, it could travel at the speed of light.
Means, you know, it be, means the mass is so small.
Yeah, it's probably nearly the speed
of light. Because we are not able to measure that much difference, that small difference. Yeah. So I also would like to thank everyone for these wonderful questions. You know, they were really good questions. And I think that my talk maybe was little, I had a simpler standard after the questions, I thought. So I hope that you enjoyed it, every one of you.
Yeah, and also I wanted to tell you that this talk will be available in ICTS Talks. And so you can see it again later, and so thanks Shobhapathy again for this wonderful talk and session, question answer session. Thank you. So maybe we can leave now and leave the meeting now.
Yes.